Hello again. It's great to be with you today. And I hope that yesterday you wrote down a lot of the great insights that Mark shared, because I've actually lived through a lot of that. And as he said it, I thought he's articulating in such a great sentence or phrase an experience that took me months or even years to learn. So please glean from the wisdom of what he shared yesterday. So we've talked about calling. We've talked about perseverance to the calling. And today we're going to make a shift where we're going to focus on the role of community, or team is the word that we often use. Because before we were dealing with how I need to personally align myself with God's direction and God's timing so that I can answer this call. But what does team have to do with me being faithful to the call? Or even deeper, what does team have to do with us in spiritual warfare? You see, I'm going to read this passage from Exodus chapter 17 that illustrates the fact that it's not just one person that's necessary in a spiritual battle. And if we think that pioneering a new Chi Alpha or going to the marketplace with the gospel or going to the nations is not anything short of spiritual warfare, then we're not understanding the challenge that we're being called to. So listen to these verses in Acts 17, beginning with verse number 8. Then Amalek came and fought against Israel at Rephidim. So Moses said to Joshua, "Choose men for us and go out, fight against Amalek. Tomorrow I will station myself on the top of the hill with the staff of God in my hand." Joshua did as Moses told him and fought against Amalek. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. So it came about when Moses held his hand up that Israel prevailed. And when he let his hand down, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy. Then they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. And Aaron and Hur supported his hands, one on one side and one on the other. Thus his hands were steady until the sun set. So Joshua overwhelmed Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. So picture this scene. You've got Joshua with soldiers, and they are marching into a valley to face an enemy. What do militaries do? They rely on strategy and methods. They rely on the instincts that have been honed over drills and over going over the same thing over and over. And this is a huge part of teamwork when it comes to working overseas. We look at our principles, we look at our values, we look at our strategies, and we go over and over these things. But what else is in this story? When you look from the valley up to the hill, you see the prophet up there with his hands raised up. And look at the connection between what happens on the hill and what transpires in the valley. You could always say that the valley is where the battle is taking place, but where the victory is being won is actually up on the hill. You can't minimize the fact that if the soldiers don't go into the battle, there's no victory. But you also can't deny the fact that if Moses doesn't pray and intercede, then God doesn't give a breakthrough. Teamwork. How does it work? When you think of how many times you get discouraged and you reach out to someone, I look back to the days and I think fondly of my small groups in Chi Alpha, the memories we had, the way that we encouraged each other. We even kept up with each other for several years after I was finished with that phase of ministry and life. This is the kind of thing we're always talking about, life on life, life groups, small group. But how does that translate into ministry when we're up against tangible enemies that are trying to overwhelm what God has called us to do? When we look at this story, Aaron and Hur may have played a role that seems relatively insignificant until you weigh it against the overall strategic victory God gave that day. I mean, they just found a rock for Moses to sit on and they just held his arms up. But in actuality, that is a picture of teamwork. Maybe God has someone for a strategic purpose, but there are people around that individual that have the concrete solutions that make his or her effectiveness all the more possible. And so I would like to close our meditation today with some insights I've gained over the years by living alongside Africans. I found that Africans are much more attuned to the spiritual warfare than I naturally am. They live in a world that's animated by an awareness of God's presence and the presence of evil forces. So I've really watched them and learned from them. And so I wrote down three basic principles they've taught me about how teams or how praying in groups can impact the effectiveness of what we do among the nations. So listen to these real quickly with me. The first one is this: people pray more intensely when they pray together. Have you ever been in a Chi Alpha meeting and someone's praying and you're agreeing and all of a sudden there's energy in the room? You can tell that there's just this collective belief God's going to do this thing, and it causes an intensity that's often hard to capture when we're on our own. People pray more intensely when they pray together. The second lesson I learned is this: teams built on prayer face the true enemy instead of making enemies out of each other. So many times we get frustrated and the natural response is to start pointing fingers. Well, our problems is because this wasn't done well, or that person didn't pull through, or I've been hurt by something that was said by one of my teammates. But when we put spiritual warfare and teamwork together at the center of what we do, it makes it hard for the devil to creep into what God is trying to achieve, because now he's starting to show us this is the enemy trying to come in the camp. And it's not just that soldiers go out to battle, it's that prophets pray. And it's not just that prophets pray, but others come alongside those leaders to help keep their arms lifted up. And all of us play a concrete role in the end result. So teams built on prayer face the true enemy instead of making enemies out of each other. The last thing I've really learned from Africans on this, and it's a very powerful one because I seemingly don't learn it quickly and have had to relearn it over the years, and it's that ministry done before adequate prayer is offered up always is doomed for failure. Think about that for a moment. So many times we pray when we run into an obstacle or we feel we're at a dead end. But what the Africans have taught me, why would you wait until you're in a problem to pray? Why don't you pray before you go into the battle? Why don't you recognize that the battle is not your strategy and your methods put into action, that the real battle is God's anointing and power falling on you? So I hope today, as we've meditated on things that our African brothers and sisters can teach us and the life of Moses can illustrate for us, that it gives us fertile thought for how our teamwork can make an impactful difference on spiritual warfare, both on our campuses, in the marketplace, and around the world.